Truth Connections.
Question is, what's real, what's deception, what should we pay attention to? What is it that's driving us insane?
Truth Connection.
Something happened in here.
Truth Connection.
Hello, everyone. Good evening. This is Catherine Buckalew. You're listening to Truth Connections Radio. Thanks for being here in the audience or listening to us afterwards in the archives. Also, please feel free to visit truthconnections.wordpress.com. There are tabs at the top right that will lead you to our Facebook page or YouTube channel if you'd like to join or subscribe to those, or check out our upcoming show schedule, archives, or other resources we have there. First of all, tonight, I would like to ask everyone to please keep the people of Oklahoma in your prayers. If you are local and can help out in any way with those families or people that have been affected, please do so. I'm sure they would appreciate it. A medical intuitive is a psychic or an intuitive counselor who specializes in perceiving information in the human body. It is done intuitively by scanning the body for areas of imbalance that may need alignment. In the mid-1800s, Dr. Quimbley was credited with over 38,000 miracle cures in an 11-year period. I find that 11-year number very interesting, by the way. Other famous medical intuitives include Edgar Cayce, Carolyn Miss, and Louise Hay, and more recently, John of God. Tonight's guest is Dr. Rita Louise. She is the chairman of the board for the International Association of Medical Intuitives. She served on the board for the Holistic Chamber of Commerce, founder of Applied Energetics, and the North End Psychic Fair. She's also on the National Registration of Who's Who in Executives and Professionals. She graduated from Berkeley Psychic Institute and studied meditation, energy medicine, and honed her clairvoyant abilities while there. She is a professor of alternative studies at Westbrook University and has a naturopath degree for over 20 years and a Ph.D. in natural health counseling. Rita is also a Reiki master, certified hypnotherapist, medical intuitive, and former pastor with studies also in philosophy, esoteric arts, health and wellness, archaeology, and human origins. She is also the author of Man-Made, The Chronicles of the Extraterrestrial Gods, Dark Angels, An Insider's Guide to Ghost Spirits and Attached Entities, and Avoiding the Cosmic 2x4. Rita has also authored various audio materials. She has been a consultant to several radio and television shows, and she also hosts her own weekly show called Just Energy Radio. Rita is a contributor to several publications and has been a keynote speaker for various radio shows, television, and she's also been a speaker for certain events like Paradigm Symposium, Whole Life Expo, MUFON, and the Institute of Noetic Sciences. Please help me welcome Dr. Rita Louise to the show. Welcome, Rita.
Hey, Kathy. Nice talking to you.
Nice talking to you, too. I like you. You're one of my new favorite people.
Yay.
I love that word. I say yay as often as possible. Rita, since it's your first time here, first of all, thank you for being with us tonight. Since it's your first time here, would you mind going into a little bit of the history from your childhood that you mentioned? What made you want to be an intuitive?
When I was young, there was two TV shows. One was The Amazing Kreskin, and Kreskin, who's still alive and with us, is a mentalist. And he had ESP, and so he would do kind of this variety psychic show, which was really cool. And then at the same time, there was a series called The Sixth Sense that featured a college professor who was in charge of the parapsychology department of the local university, and he had ESP too. And You know, so he would go into a room and he would like pick up a piece of paper and he would see that Mary was going to like be in her car and it would swerve around on it, you know, on this road and then fly off the cliff, you know, down the rocks into the ocean. And he would run out and stop her in time and, you know, they'd find out that the brake lines were cut.
Wow.
And I was like, whoa. And so I decided that's what I wanted to do. And learn, you know, learn how to do. And so I just started reading books on, you know, psychic stuff, except in the library, you know, there was like six or seven books on psychic stuff. And then the next like Dewey Decimal number over was witchcraft, which I wasn't going to touch.
Right.
And, you know, but then I got turned on to more philosophical things because really that was what was out and available. You know, Carlos Castaneda and Ram Dass and those kind of authors. And then, you know, moving for more into the 80s, you know, like Louise Hay that you spoke about or Shakti Gwan and those type of, you know, self-help intuition people. But I never really felt like I was psychic. I knew that. If you were enlightened, then you would have psychic abilities as a byproduct. That I had learned.
Right.
And I felt more enlightened than my friends, but I still wasn't psychic. So I started studying at the Berkeley Psychic Institute. And after being in their program, I discovered that I had been very psychic my whole life. And no one ever connected the dots for me. So, you know, one situation I had, I was at work and making a not so long story, but fairly long story, very short. I walked up to a gentleman just innocently and said, well, where were you yesterday? Having them check for a brain tumor, which was where he had been the day before. But I didn't realize that that was like having a psychic moment. You know, I just thought it was like this very weird, coincidental, like creepy kind of thing, but I just blew it off. And I mean, that happened. That was a very profound experience, but I just kind of blew it off when these things would happen, only to find out that when it was happening, those were psychic experiences. Seeing people's past lives, that is a psychic experience. And so apparently I've been doing it my whole life and just never knew it. And I think, you know, that's one of the things that I talk a lot about in presentations is how we all have that gift. And many times we don't realize that in doing the things that we do, we are utilizing our psychic abilities.
Now, you have a lot of credits to your name. Do you consider yourself to have always been a right brain thinker, left brain, or mostly pretty much balanced?
I can jump back and forth pretty easily. You know, so I can be very analytical at times, and then I can just be really in the moment. I always find it funny because when you're in a reading space, like if I'm at a show, you know, a conference or a trade show, psychic fair, and I'm doing a lot of session work, do not ask me to make change. Do not ask me to spell any, I mean, not that I can spell anything anyway, but, you know, don't expect me to write anything out that is, you know, beyond phonetical because it just doesn't, you know, I go over into that brain further.
Right.
And it becomes harder to, like, jump back to the other brain.
I always said I never worried about being a great speller or a typer because somehow I always knew instinctively that telepathy was going to come into play, so I didn't have to worry about it, you know? I can't wait for that to happen. Have you ever had any... Are there any profound paranormal events in your young life or young adult life or even now that triggered your studies? Or did that come into play when you developed your paranormal ability?
You mean like paranormal as in ghosty paranormal?
Yeah. Have you ever, as a child or young adult?
Yeah, I grew up in a haunted house. Actually, you know, from a information that I have now, it was a residual haunting. There was a dead guy that lived in the basement. Everybody knew him. Except nobody talked about him. And then actually I was having a whole conversation with somebody about this today. When I was in college, I lived off campus for a year, my second year of college. And the house that I lived in had been the town funeral parlor with viewing rooms and everything. And that place was haunted. Oh, my God. There was so much activity going on in that place. It was... Yeah.
I'm sure there was because there's a lot of bodies that went in and out of there. Rita, how describe to us what a typical day in your practice is and what you utilize with your practice. I know you're a medical intuitive and you do regression and you do counseling. What do you mainly focus on with your practice when you help people heal?
I mean, I really don't do much regression work. When someone comes in, I mean, I have basically two categories of people. People that come in just because they are wanting a psychic reading, they have something going on in their relationship, they have something going on at work, and they're looking for some guidance, you know. And so I tend to be a problem solver. So it's like, you know, hit me with your issues. Just, you know, tell me what your issues are and let's just kind of work through them. You know, there is definitely part that's intuitive, looking at the dynamics of what's going on, looking at where their energy is in relationship to the situation. You know, and then there's always a certain amount of just plain counseling that happens as part of that scenario. You know, what do you, you know, now that you have this information, what are you going to do? You know, and what seems like the path that is going to present the least amount of obstacles, or what obstacles do I see coming up for you in that area? The other big group of that I have are people that have health concerns. You know, they have gone to their doctor, you know, with some kind of complaint, or they haven't gone to their doctor with some kind of complaint, and they need some inside guidance and advice. You know, in a session like that, you know, there are a lot of people that believe or feel that because you're a medical intuitive, you're just supposed to be like, oh, boop, this is what's going on with you. And I mean, I don't work that way. I'm a clairvoyant, which means I look. And so I have to look at your entire body to really make a deep determination of what's going on. So my feeling is, if you're calling me because you have a health issue, you already know where your owies are. If your shoulder's hurting, just say, my shoulder hurts.
What does it look like when you see the energy on someone's body that is blocked?
Well, see, I don't just look at the energy. I'm able to look in people's bodies. And so if somebody complains, let's say that they have a sore shoulder, I will look at the muscles. I'll look at the bones, you know, because there might be inflammation in the joint. There might be torn ligaments or, you know, something else going on. And so when I work with someone, I work on multiple levels, you know, especially if it's a health concern. I always start looking very deep in the body on a very physical level. You know, what is going on functionally and structurally? You know, because sometimes things that we're experiencing are more, they can be energetic in nature. Sometimes not. Sometimes they are just totally physical, you know. And so I make those kind of separations. Give them clarity, you know, because sometimes people will go to the doctor and the doctor will be like, well, I think it's this, you know, and when you look at them, what they present with energetically is not what the doctors say. I mean, because different health concerns present in different ways. It's kind of like doing this work, you develop kind of a library. So if someone says, well, the doctor said that I had a stroke, to me, someone that has had a stroke, it looks like they have these little holes in their brains. Hmm. Versus if they have epilepsy, it's kind of weird. It's kind of like they show me these little lightning bolts, you know, or if they have some kind of an infection going on, you know, if it's bacterial, I always get this image. It's really kind of gross, but bizarre. Kind of like it's not a Petri dish, but kind of what you would expect with a Petri dish. And there's like one or two little cells, and then they just multiply and, like, you know, go out of control. That's an indication of a bacterial infection, where if it's fungal, because a lot of the times they overlap, you know, diagnostically will overlap, I will notice the congestion or the area of discomfort, but it just seems there. You know, there's not really growth to it. It's just there.
So you receive images similar to the way a medium would receive images of, like, a dead one showing her flowers. And
right.
And she reads the reading that way and says, well, this flowers means this and this means that sort of things. But you actually see inside the body and you see different pictures, basically, for different types of illnesses.
Right. And I mean, if there's something really structural going on, you know, the person has an ulcer or if the person has a torn ligament, I can be like, here's a picture of your, you know, my little funky pictures. Here's a little funky picture of your stomach. And right here on your stomach is where the ulcer is. And I'll like point to their body. I go, but on the backside, you know, and they're like, yeah, that's where it hurts.
Right.
You know, but that's one piece. But I believe that many diseases, the majority of issues that we face are not just functional in origin, that there is some psycho-spiritual, emotional belief thing that's tied to it. And so I will start on the very physical level and then work my way out of the subtle bodies and start talking about the emotional part or the belief part that is tied to it.
Because we are not just physical bodies. We are who we tell ourselves we are in our own minds. And I can see that having a lot to do with it, you know, making people sick, because it does, you know. Helps people. It causes people to retain extra weight and be sad and all that stuff.
Develop cancer, get gallbladder disease, create issues with their kidneys. I mean, develop pretty much, you know, short of falling on the ground and breaking your leg, you know, or getting some kind of a virus, even though there are people that attribute, you know, spiritual pieces to that, I kind of leave that to the side.
Now, how would, just for the sake of the audience, if they want to seek assistance from you, do they have to be right there in person with you, or can they do it on Skype, or does it even have to be in video at all?
No, I've been doing this for a long, long, long time, before Skype was even invented. No, the majority of my clients, I work with by phone, and so we just talk on the phone.
Great.
I mean, you know, if they're in an international area that might happen to be listening, I will Skype, you know, but I don't do the video part.
What is your feelings on all of these new childhood illnesses like autism? Not that it's new, but they seem to be happening on a more regular occurrence to children that are born, like autism and ADD and food allergies. What is your vibe that is? Is it the injections? Is it just star children? What would you say that those illnesses have something to do with?
I have a pretty politically unpopular viewpoint. I mean, I do believe that there's a certain percent that are attributed to the vaccines and that kind of thing.
So do I.
But my feeling is that things like the ADD and some of these other issues, you know, young cancer, things like that, are attributed to, and this is the part that is the unpopular part, is that the health of the parent and the nutritional wholeness of the parent is not that good. And so they're pregnant and they're not necessarily fully nourishing their child because they don't have it in them.
Also, they could be consuming a lot of GMO products.
I mean, that all kind of fits into they eat too much McDonald's, you know, whatever that is. But that, you know, there is this thing that I heard many years ago, and it was a Pottinger's cat. And he talks about these cats that one group was given like unpasteurized milk and raw meat to eat. And another group was given cooked meat and pasteurized milk. And over the generations of these cats, the ones that were giving the cooked food and the pasteurized milk, within like 5 or 6 generations were one dying younger, developing more illnesses and were having fertility issues. And then after a few more generations, they were basically infertile. And I look around, I mean, how many women do you hear about that are having fertility issues?
A lot.
A lot. And it just always makes me go back to that story. And I do believe, you know, I kind of believe that the baby boomers are really the last relatively healthy generation because everybody else was brought up on TV dinners. And fast food.
Yeah, that's true. When I grew up with a garden, And I'm very grateful for that, you know, because I think it gave me a really solid foundation. And it is very important because, you know, what you eat tells your DNA what to do, and what you tell yourself, your DNA does too. So it has a lot to do with it. What do you think is happening with these chimeras? Do you think they are genetically... Because I'm a firm believer that we're right on the edge of Atlantis, you know, and with how they're playing God with mixing DNA with plants and animals and insects.
Well, you know, it's interesting. In my book, Man-Made, The Chronicles of Our Extraterrestrial Gods, one of the things that I touch on is the topic of domestication. But one of my favorite pieces that kind of fell during that same time period was that 9,000 years ago, and I'm not paraphrasing this exact, but a form of goat grass and elkhorn wheat, some other, it was two different species of plants. Okay, so basically, you know, when we talk about a species, we're talking about like a cat or a dog. They're two different species, you know, an apple and a cherry. And so you can't take an apple tree and a cherry tree and make a cher apple tree, you know, and have viable offspring. You know, it just don't work. You know, can't have cat dogs. But somehow, some way, a miracle occurred, and these two forms, one was a kind of wheat and the other one was grass, seemed to cross, and boom. We had this new kind of wheat that had more gluten and it was easier to make bread. And then in about 3,000, 3,500 BC, it happened again with this modified wheat mixing with a different kind of grass that made the kind of wheat we have today. You know, and I think it's very interesting that we are starting to do things that I believe the gods of our past did for us.
Yes.
Except we're not very good at it.
Yes, I agree. What do you think about, I'm sure you probably believe that they are manipulating different and splicing different species in black budget programs. What are your thoughts on that? What effect do you think that'll have on humanity?
Well, I mean, it's kind of scary, that whole thing, because it's like we're in one giant experiment and nobody knows what the answer is, but they're just doing it. I mean, the other day I had the TV on and they were going on and on and on and on and on about Angela Jolie having a double mastectomy, which to me, I'm just like, okay, you know, I don't know that I would mutilate myself that way because I had a fear that something might happen, you know, that, and that's just that's my choice, you know, but researchers are saying that it's a way to prevent breast cancer. It's like, okay, but if you look at diseases in other parts of the body, it's like if you have an issue with your gallbladder and they remove it, it doesn't get rid of the energetic part of why you got gallbladder disease in the first place.
Right.
And it doesn't mean that it won't manifest somewhere else in some other way. So I've just lopped my breasts off and I get, you know, stomach cancer or pancreatic cancer. I mean, they don't know.
Yeah,
you know,
it could totally shift somewhere else or grow back where they initially got amputated
right.
from their body. It just doesn't make any
right.
sense to do that as preventative medicine if you don't even have any predisposition to that just because some doctor.
Well, I mean, they you know, they have this test that looks for a gene, but, you know, what is it that activates that gene?
Yes.
Yeah, you know, and that's the it's not the predisposition. To me, you know, there is some thought, there is some belief that can be passed down through a family line that could activate it. I could see that. But again, removing the organs does not get rid of the belief that created the cancer and activated that gene in the first place.
Right. Let's move on to, I don't know if we should take a break now or not, because this is probably a large topic. I'll let you be the judge, Rita. Should we talk about, I'd like to talk about how mankind was originated.
Okay.
Should we take a break now and then get back to that topic? Because I have no problem doing that.
Sure. Let's go ahead.
Probably take a long time to do that. Okay, great. All right, everyone. During the break, please feel free to sign up to our YouTube channel or our Facebook page, both called Truth Connections. Our first break song is by Bassfister, and it's called Third Eye. Enjoy. We'll see you back in about 3 minutes.
In many of those taking Substance D, a split between the right hemisphere and the left hemisphere of the brain occurs, which results in a defect within both the percept and cognitive systems, although apparently the cognitive continues to function normally. Have you located the familiar object in this line drawing? It should just jump right out at you. We are back with our very special guest, Dr. Rita Louise. I love you, Rita. You have a twisted, funny sense of humor. I think it's hilarious. Okay, let's go back to our original topic we're going to talk about before the break, about the origins of mankind. I know you've done a lot of research about that. You want to go into that for us?
Sure. So, that's one of the topics that we talk about in that book, Man-Made Chronicles of Our Extraterrestrial Gods. Available on Amazon, as well as the Soul Healer website. See, I might as well just, like, throw that in there as well. My husband would be so proud of me. Well, he's always getting on my case. It's like, you know, you need to mention that stuff. And I'm like, yeah, whatever. in the book, and I need to kind of give it some background, in the book, what we look at is mythology from around the world. And in our study, we realize that there is really a chronology of history that happens from a mythological viewpoint. And the stories that have come down to us from cultures around the world really parallel one another to the point that we believe that it is just really one story of our past that is being told, even though there are cultural differences and language differences and interpretation differences that have happened over the years. With that said, the story of mankind actually falls to, well, in the book, he shows up in the second to last chapter. That's how far down this whole mythological story mankind is. He's in the chapter right before the flood. So there's all this stuff, and then there's mankind, and then there's the flood. I thought that was really interesting. I mean, that was kind of an insight to me because, you know, when you read the Bible story, mankind is, boom, the world's created and then man. And when you look at myths from around the world, it doesn't play out that way.
Uh-huh.
It's almost as if the writers of the Bible, in order to get rid of these multiple gods and the stories that happen and the conflicts that happen between these multiple gods, they, well, I like to joke around, they had this like 5-gallon can of whiteout, and they just white out all of these stories. So basically it ends up reading like, well, we were created and then boom, mankind. Or, you know, the world was created and then boom, mankind. Because, you know, you can't have the conflicts like in Greek mythology. I like referring to Greek mythology because people are familiar to a certain extent of those stories. You know, you can't have the conflict between, you know, Zeus and the Titans if there's only one god. Oops. So, you know, you got to get rid of it. So when we talk about mankind, our concept is that we looked at the archaeological record, we looked at the mythological record, and one of the things that we found, actually a number of things that we found, was that there were a lot of coincidences that occurred during a very short period of time. You know, kind of like the miracle of the grain, that somehow these two distinct species mated together and produced a viable offspring, which, you know, only Monsanto can do. The same thing happened in the genetic record of humanity. So basically, we kind of start this whole story about 3 million years ago when things started to change. About 3 million years ago is when there were the Australopithecines. And so these guys, they were the first ones to present with, so like in monkeys, they have what's called a divergent big toe, which means that their big toe sticks out to the side. And so in Australopithecines, we find records, you know, fossilized records of these creatures or dating to that time period of a foot that looks relatively modern. You know, the big toe actually points forward in the same way our big toe points now. And the creature was bipedal, which means it walked on 2 feet. There's not like handprints next to it because this was a track of footprints that were left in mud that were fossilized. Also during that period, it is the first period that there was tool use, or they believe tool use. They have found these rocks that, like, the edge looks like they've been broken off. And so there are some people think that they're tools. There are other people that debate, you know, these are just natural stones that were broken, whatever. But then after that, somewhere around 2 million years ago, coming a little bit forward in time, is where things really get interesting. So between that 3 million and about 1... I mean, the magic number that I use, even though it's a very conservative number, is about 1.5 million years ago. I think the number goes back a lot further than that, but I'm being extremely conservative here. But in that 1.5 million years, a whole bunch of things happened. For example, okay, so we were already, we think, walking upright on 2 feet, and we were already starting to use tools. But by 1.5 million years ago, we were hairless. We had, from a genetic point of view, there were a number of changes to our genetic makeup, which gave us the ability to communicate, verbally communicate. That is in the genetic record. And actually, they found the same gene piece in Neanderthals, which indicate that Neanderthals also had the ability to communicate verbally. We were using tools. I mean, they were definitely tools that we were using. We had the ability to utilize fire, maybe not create fire, but at least utilize and control fire. We were starting to live in little social groups, and we were beginning to wear clothes. And it's interesting because when, you know, there are a lot of people that, you know, come from like the ancient astronaut community, and they will throw out, oh, well, you know, there has been alien intervention at like 40,000 years ago or 100,000 years ago. But when you look at it from a mythological point of view, those numbers are too short. And, you know, and I put the Adam and Eve story back with Homo erectus at that 1.5 million, you know, or more years back, because two important things. One is in the mythological record. Are you familiar with the story of Prometheus, for example?
Yes.
You know, so Prometheus gave mankind fire, and he was punished by the gods and chained to a rock. And then every night this eagle would come down and eat his liver. But since he was a god, it would regenerate and he would have to suffer the same fate every day. But that was because he gave the gods or gave mankind fire. But that story of the gods giving mankind fire and that the god who gives mankind fire is always identified as like a trickster kind of character, which Prometheus is identified with. Loki from the Norse tradition is identified as a trickster god, which leads me to believe that we're really talking about the same story and the same god, because it's always a trickster god. You know, mankind never figured out how to make fire. I think we're really kind of stupid. But anyway, but it's true. But by 100,000 years ago, there we clearly were able to use fire. And so it could not have been 100,000 years ago that there was some kind of intervention into the heritage of mankind. And it's interesting because even in the Bible, when God kicks Adam and Eve out of the Garden of Eden, one of the things God does is makes them a little outfit out of fur and kicks them out.
Yeah.
I always think of like Barbie clothes when I think of that image, like little fur Barbie clothes.
Now, I want to get back to the different types of gods, but I wanted to ask you quickly before we moved on. The Orang Pendek is a 2 to 3 foot tall being that's found in the rainforest of Indonesia. And there's a hominoid called Florence that was discovered in 2003. And even to go as far as Bigfoot and werewolves. Do you think that they are the remnants of genetically engineered, quote-unquote, evolution by the gods, or are they more of a multidimensional being?
Okay. Well, I didn't think we were going here. well, you know, mythology is filled with all kinds of creatures. You know, we have the dwarfs, and we have these other little people. We have the fairies. And so it is not uncommon to hear about the wee people. And so finding the remnants of a wee person really doesn't surprise me at all. With context to Bigfoot, you know, was that, you know, there's a story that comes out of India that talks about, I mean, it parallels a biblical story, but I'll just tell the Indian story, and let's see if you can figure it out. But there's a story that comes out of the Ramayana that talks about when Rama was born, they knew that he was going to have to battle with the demon god of Lanka at some point in time. And so Vishnu told all of the other gods to go down to the earth and have relations with the monkeys and the bears on the planet. And the offspring of these relations were these ape men that had special powers. You know, they had, you know, higher intellects. If their father was the god of the wind, they could harness the power of the wind to do things. I mean, not in a full godlike capability, but better than the other apes and monkeys. You know, they were better set. And, you know, and it just makes me wonder if, based on that story, if what we find of Bigfoot, I mean, because I believe that, you know, and I've had this argument with a couple of people, I believe that we are the ape men, and perhaps the bears are Bigfoot, perhaps.
Could be.
You know, I'm just kind of throwing that out there.
A lot of people believe that Bigfoot is a multidimensional being, and it could very well be both. Who knows?
I don't know about that. But
yeah, I'm not sure either. But a lot of people do believe he's a multidimensional being, and that you know there are different areas because they seem to be pretty Jedi and keep avoiding people. I think that's the main reason. And they are telepathic supposedly, so they do have some Jedi powers.
Well, I mean, even in a lot of literature, you find that there are creatures that live in the mountains, that live in caves, and live in woods, you know, and that is their domain, you know, and so are they remnants of some other race that inhabits the earth, you know, and just kind of hides out? I think it's a possibility.
I know that you also speak about there being possibly two ark stories, that there might have been two floods. Some people believe there was two arcs, one, I think, in Iran, and one, some mountain. I forget which one it is.
You mean like Noah's Ark?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm not even going to go there. No, one of the things that we found in researching was that there, I mean, other than that, there are flood stories that you find around the world that parallel the Noah story, you know, and they talk about a pious man being warned about a flood, and he builds a boat or an ark or climbs a tree or climbs to the top of the mountain, and it goes there with a couple of people, his wife, his kids, maybe his brother, very small group of people, maybe some animals. That's one narrative that you find around the world. But there's a secondary narrative that you find around the world that also talks about a flood. And it's interesting because people will just lump them all together and it creates a lot of confusion. But what we discovered is that in this other narrative, you know, it just says, and there was a flood. But it doesn't really give a lot of details as to, you know, what the storyline is. But how we segregated it out, and this was really interesting, was that there was a flood. And then after the flood, the gods put the sun, the moon, and the stars in the sky. And so there's always something happens, there's a flood, and then the gods come and put the sun, the moon, and the stars in the sky. And that's how we really put this book together, was looking for these common themes. It's like, ooh, sun, moon, and the stars in the sky. Okay, this goes, you know, it was kind of our sorting bin. Here's our sun, moon, and the sky bin. And then when you started looking, you would find these common themes coming up. What's interesting is that in the biblical story, okay, so in the Bible, in the story of creation, I mean, they don't really talk about a flood that early, but in the story on day three, in these stories also, so there's the flood, and then they terraform the planet. They use the body of, like, Ymir was this giant from Norse mythology. He was one of the creator gods. And they chop up his body, and his blood becomes the rivers, and his hair becomes the trees, and, you know, and his body parts, his, you know, teeth become the mountains, you know, and his body parts form the earth. And then they put the sun, moon, and stars in the sky. I forgot about that part. Okay, now if you look at the biblical narrative, all right, and you have to really pay attention to timeline, in the biblical narrative on day three, God creates the plants and the trees. And then on day four, God puts the sun, the moon, and the stars in the sky. Now, being a little scientific, I don't know, you know, how can plants and trees grow if there's no sun in the sky?
True.
I think we had photosynthesis back then.
Hmm.
You know? And what, you know, originally when we first started this project, I thought that maybe the biblical authors kind of got the days mixed up. And there are a lot of people that believe that, you know, day 3 and 4 should be reverse. But having read all of these stories from around the world, no, that's not the case. It is, well, the flood part, and then the world is created, you know, or terraformed. I like terraform better. And then the sun, the moon, and the stars are put into place, which actually matches the biblical story. And I was like, dang, that's pretty good.
What do you think, Rita, about all the ancient text in relationship to, you know, the ancient artwork? I mean, there's all kinds of cultures that seem to have the same visual representations of the gods or vimanas or flying saucers.
Well, I believe that their representations are talking about the same person. Huh. You know, so it's not that, you know, they're similar. You know, I'm working on a piece right now that I don't really want to divulge too much, but it really is looking at imagery. And I'm going to use the word iconography, you know, what something looks like. But I'll give this example. If we saw, so the very first image, all right, hang on, I'm going to be correct about this. It was in 1864. Well, I have these notes because I was working on this today. In 1864, this guy, I think it's Thomas More, wrote a book called A Visit from St. Nicholas. And in that book, he actually has a picture that I'm sure if you showed it to anyone, they would go, it's Santa.
Hmm.
Okay? I mean, he's wearing a yellow jacket. He hadn't been, like, locked into the red coat, which didn't happen until the late 1800s, early 1900s, you know, where he's in that iconic red coat. But he's in a coat with the fur collar, and he's got his bag, you know, kind of thing. And so I think anybody, if shown that image, would immediately identify that person with Santa. And so I believe that when we see these images that look remarkably alike, it is because they are all talking about the same person with certain cultural artistic style differences.
It could very well be. Very well be. The next topic that I'd like to get into is also lengthy, so I think we should probably take our next break. Again, I don't want to stop you in the middle of discussing it.
Cool. I'm just following along with you.
Okay. All right, thank you. All right, everyone, our next song is by Fred Cusinato, and it's called A New Earth, and it's in 432 hertz. Enjoy it. We'll see you back in about 5 minutes. Thank you. We are back with our very special guest, Dr. Rita Louise. This is Kathy. Thanks to the audience for listening in as well. Thanks for being here, everyone. I'd like to talk about a topic that I think confuses a lot of people, Rita. I think everybody has the habit of putting every multidimensional being in the same basket, so to speak. Why don't we start off with describing what disembodied spirits are?
A one-size-fits-all multidimensional being.
Everybody
basket.
Everybody blames the ETs, you know? So.
No, the devil made me do it. Well, you know, it's interesting, and it depends on what world you come out of, you know, because if you talk to someone that's in the ghost hunting world, there might be a couple that might throw them into the alien pot, but most of them won't. The bulk of them won't. I mean, this has been my experience, you know, is that I come out of the ghost hunting world, I come out of the psychic world, where I have, even before I was doing ghost hunting stuff, was dealing with entities. And so to me, an entity or a being is something, someone or something that doesn't have a body. Now, in my work, I've dealt with a couple of different kind, ones that take on corporeal form, you know, so they look like peeps, you know, they look like us, they wear clothes, you know, they might not be from our current time period or dressed in that way, but they are definitely human in nature. And when you interact with them, they, you know, I like to say they speak human. You know, it's kind of like they speak English, and so you can relate to things on a similar level. You know, we all know what a chair is if you're speaking human. But then there's this other group of beings that I've interacted with that, you know, not as often, but they definitely are there, that I definitely call your basic alien entity, that don't take on corporeal form, but they don't take on human form. Now, they might look humanoid, but not human, you know, and then there's another group that don't even look humanoid, which usually the kind of creepier, nasty ones, that if somebody wanted to say, oh, is that a demon, I'd probably agree, because they're just creepy. You know, you wouldn't want one of those things turning up under your bed, at least if they're humanoid. You know, you can maybe wrap your mind around that concept. You know, and where they come from, I mean, the feeling that I get in interacting with them, the non-humanoid ones, is that they're not from here. They don't want to be here. They come here for periods of time. You know, the ones that I usually end up interacting with are attached to specific individuals because they want to learn through them, because they want to control and manipulate them. Because they are collecting data from them, you know, they all have very different reasons for attaching themselves to one of us living, breathing people, you know, and that's just based on my interaction with the ones that are being an attachment to someone. And it's not to say that there aren't other ones that are in, you know, in that invisible time-space zone that are just kind of hanging out. I mean, that's kind of hard to prove or disprove in any way.
I'd be more like a disembodied spirit, right?
Well, they're all disembodied spirits.
I mean, just like a regular ghost, or no.
Well, I mean, see, to me, a regular ghost always has a human form, you know, and has always, you know, will present that way, as where these things, they don't look human.
Right.
You know, and so whether they are hanging around in the same, you know, like when we think of a ghost, you know, a ghost might be attached to a location, they might be attached to something, you know, and so, but whether these non-human presences are hanging around, you know, in other places, you know, it's a little hard to tell. I think even for, you know, people that are trained to look at this kind of stuff, you know, we don't go to Gettysburg, you know, where we might want to interact or look for the spirits there. We don't put on, you know, like our spooky alien entity glasses to go, ooh, are there any alien entities hanging around here? because they do vibrate at a different level than their human counterparts. And so you have to kind of tune into them in a slightly different way.
What are your thoughts about an incubus or a succubus. And if someone does have an attachment, does that mean that they've done something to open up a doorway? Or could it just happen because someone they're with has opened up a doorway?
That's a great question. I mean, for those that are not familiar with incubuses and succubuses, but, you know, all they want is sex. And so they will come and try to have relations with an individual. It's interesting because a lot of women who have this issue, and it's not, you know, it's a, actually a pretty small percentage, but that have this issue often report or believe they've been raped, you know, but they're hard pressed in saying this is who it is, or they might blame someone that they think might have been the perpetrator when they weren't. My experience with attached entities is that the individual who has the attachment, okay, so there's, you know, and I really need to be clear, there's a difference between a ghost that's haunting and the concept of an attached entity, because an attached entity has an agenda of its own, and it will attach to a very specific person for a very specific reason. And usually they don't want you to know that they're there. And so they're just as happy that you blame, you know, if you're a girl, that you blame your dad for raping you as a child, because you're not blaming the entity. You're blaming somebody else, and so that you are unaware of its presence. It does not want its presence known or busted. So with that said, there is always some kind of an agreement that exists between the individual and the entity, you know, and the individual always opens the door and allows the entity in, always. So it's not like you can go to a haunted house and, you know, pick up an attached entity. Now, you can bring an entity home with you. They might follow you home, but it won't attach to you unless there are a number of specific circumstances that occur, you know, with you specifically. Now, with that said, I have dealt with people who believe they have an entity attachment, but the reality is that there is somebody in their location that has the entity attachment, and the entity is wandering over and bugging the other people. So, like, I can think of one case where I was working with this woman who thought she had an entity attachment. I didn't see one. Her boyfriend, however, had a big old one, and her boyfriend was coming and bugging. Her boyfriend's entity was coming and bothering her.
Because I do know some of these incubus and succubi, they can come to people on the dream state, but a lot of times they wake those people up. And they hurt them in the process. But I also know that on the dream state, there are several people that I've spoke to who are having situations where something is coming to them on the dream state and milking them for kundalini. What kind of situation is that? It's not quite an incubus-succubus situation. I call it a nice incubus-succubus, one that doesn't hurt you. But it certainly can manipulate your energy in certain places, if you know what I mean, even after you, long after you wake up. What do you think that is? Is that something that someone agreed to?
See, I'm not familiar with that situation. I am not a dream person. So if somebody says, well, you know, I've been having these dreams, I'm like, don't talk to me about it. you know, and what rules apply on the astral plane are totally different, you know, and I don't explore that. So I'm just going to say I don't really have an answer for you on that. How's that?
No.
Is that something I would totally make up? That may or may not be true.
I think a lot of people are having different situations happen to them that they've never heard of, like this situation. And then they wonder, what can I do? How can I get rid of these beings? What is something someone can do to protect themselves against these beings? And I have a friend who wants to call in too, so I'll do that right after you finish.
Okay. You know, it's not really about protecting yourself. It's about not inviting them in. You know, the most common place that an entity attaches is in childhood. And so by the time you're an adult, it's like you've already had this long ongoing relationship with the entity. The other common place is through addictive behavior, drugs, alcohol, gambling, pornography, internet, sex. You know, all of those are or can be the result of an entity attachment.
Hmm.
You know, once we're an adult, I mean, because it really has to do with boundary issues, you know, our personal boundary issues. You know, once we're an adult, it's a little more challenging for these things to step in. However, I've worked with a number of people who have done things like, you know, they always talk about, you know, don't play with the Ouija board. You know, but it's not about playing with the Ouija board in the general sense of the word. It's about giving up your power to the information that the Ouija board might provide to you. Did that make sense to you? Or do I need to
explain
that?
I'm a firm believer in not to mess with the Ouija boards. That's
but I'm not even talking. I mean, I'm just using that as an example.
Right.
I've had people that have done automatic writing.
Right.
You know, and they start giving up their power to the information that they're channeling through the automatic writing.
Right.
You know, and
get greedy.
Well, they don't get greedy, but they just, you know, the being that is communicating with them, because, you know, they don't ask and they're not very specific, the being that's communicating with them starts off and it's like tells them all this good stuff and, you know, kind of builds them up, and then they build this trust and now they create this relationship. And as they're creating the relationship, it's like this entity is sticking its foot in the door, and once it's firmly implanted, it changes the game. And then it starts becoming a nuisance and meddling and becoming negative, you know, and they might hold the door open, you know, kind of like a cat door, and you got neighborhood cats and you got all these cats coming in your house now. I mean, the same kind of thing can happen.
Right. They pretend to be your friend and then flip a switch.
Right. I've seen it happen with individuals who follow the belief that, well, I called in my angels. I mean, I tell people, you know what, don't do it, you know, because just because you say, oh, I want my angels to come in and help me, it's like you don't know who you're calling. One of the big things is that
Right. If
you're in a bad emotional place, you might call in a being that is shining with a brighter light than you are in that moment. But when, you know, but when you get back to where you are normally, that being could potentially be a much lower vibrating energy. You know, so if you've had one of those days, you know, where you get up and your hot water heater has exploded so you can't take a shower, but you got to go to work to get to a meeting, and on your way to work you have a car accident, and then you find out, you know what I mean? And just one of those days where you think, I shouldn't even have gotten out of bed, you know, and you're really just in a bad place, you know, or a phase where you're going to just this bad phase, you know, it's in those times, it's when we are emotionally down that we need to take the most precaution, because our boundaries are lower, and that's when these guys can step in.
Right.
I've heard stories. I have not worked with someone that has had this situation, but it makes sense to me. Individuals that are in hospitals, you know, your immune system, our aura, I believe, is connected to our immune system. You know, our immune system is lessened. Our boundaries are lessened. We're in a bad place. We might be in a drug-induced place.
Prescriptive medication?
Well, there is entity attachment because you are drugged. You know what I mean? When we talk about, like, a drug or, you know, addiction issue, it's like there's someone and they're like a really nice guy, but then you put a bunch of alcohol into them and they do this on a regular basis and they become somebody else. Well, they become somebody else is because they have given up ownership of their body and they let some entity in. And so if someone is using prescription medications, you know, as addictive behavior, I could see that becoming an issue. But I can also see where if they give you drugs in the hospital, or you're just very sick, you know, and you're praying, you know, it's like, oh, you know, I want to feel better, you know what I mean? That kind of thing, and you're praying to God, that you could totally get an entity attachment out of that. But in your prayers, you're opening the door. That is the door. Will someone please come save me?
Oh, I see.
Oh,
that's very
enter stage left. You know, so for someone that has one because of an addiction issue, you know, the easiest way to get rid of it is to stop indulging in the addiction.
Right.
You know,
salt bass, burnt sage, holy water cannon, perhaps. You know,
no,
it works.
No, it doesn't work.
No,
not with an attached entity.
Do you think an exorcism is in order if that's the case?
No, I mean, I guess you could.
Or do you think that'll just piss it off more?
Well, I mean, you know, I've seen like exorcisms on TV and I find them extremely annoying because, you know, we have an entity is usually a low vibrating spirit. You know, they got bad energy. So if you're sitting there going, I remove you in the name of Jesus Christ, it's like, I mean, if I was a spirit and someone was yelling that crap at me, I'd get pissed off.
There's a very informed friend of mine that can't wait to ask you a question, Rita. I'm going to bring him on the line now.
Okay, no.
Hi, Stephen. Rita, this is Stephen Kelly. He wants to ask you a couple questions.
Stephen, hi, Stephen.
Dr. Rita Louise.
Rita, I've enjoyed your stuff on the internet. I've seen it for quite. Every time I look through some reference, I usually run into your stuff. So thank you for that.
Yay.
The issue with the succubus and whatnot, I wanted to ask you real quick about. You're familiar with the story of Lilith and the Hebrew mythology surrounding the Lilith character.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. Well, I like to. Whenever people start talking about the succubus, I want to go back to Lilith because she was the original succubus. And you know, if you read the Hebrew mythology surrounding that character, it's quite an interesting story. And it's you know, I think that ties in very closely with some of the extraterrestrials that are doing their cloning and whatnot. It's very similar to the collecting of the genetic material for the purposes of creating these other beings. Do you agree with that?
Part.
I like Rita. She's gangsta.
Yeah.
Okay, give me a few drinks. I'll be that guy you guys were talking about a minute ago here.
Oh, Lord.
I'm going to send you some energy. Watch out.
You know, but we just run into some problems. I mean, if it is a, you know, incubuses, or my experience, incubuses and succubus they're non-corporeal. So if they're coming here to get genetic material exists on the physical plane. You know, so we run into that kind of issue. You know, so, I mean, having them come and feed off of us energetically, I totally could buy that. You know, but I don't even know how much I buy the whole Lilith mythology because you don't really find that narrative per se in other cultural storylines.
Well, there's probably a good reason for that. You know, if you even look at the way they have recorded their history, you know, verbal, mouth to mouth, there probably was a lot of effort put into keeping these things quiet. And I, you know, if you go back to the Middle Ages or the Dark Ages when this sort of thing was being written and recorded, it's been suppressed from both sides. So I just, you know, and if you look at popular culture today with the Lilith Festival and the feminists celebrating the Lilith character, nobody really takes any time to really look into what exactly the character represents. And it's not a good thing.
You know, but when I look at mythology, one of my marking posts is looking at Australian mythology, because to me, Australian mythology goes back at least 40,000 years, if not longer. And so that's one of my guiding things. Or if I find it in Native American or South American mythology, because that mythology in its core can go back somewhere between 12 and 20,000 years ago. I mean, I like Western mythology, but I don't base my work on Western mythology. I have to find parallels in these other cultural groups that are indigenous in nature that have not moved through more advanced civilization. You know, one of the things that I love about the Australians in particular is that, you know, people go, oh, well, they came into contact with these other cultural groups, but you know, and they gave them that information. It's like, well, if they gave them that information, then maybe these other cultural groups could have taught them, like, how to plant a seed or how to build a little house or how to do all of these things that have a bow and arrow, have these things that we find in other cultures around the world that are not found in Aboriginal culture. And so if their stories came, none of their technology came. And it doesn't make sense that they would take on a mythological base without taking on at least some of the technological base.
Well, I do want to say one thing. When you talk about the cultures that have histories that go back 40,000 years and what have you, you're talking about histories, recorded histories that go back beyond this current epoch. I believe we do have these epochs, and our recorded history right now only goes back to the beginning of this current epoch. So if you go back to the last one, which would be Atlantis and Lemuria and all that, you see that these cultures that are involved in these creating these mythologies, i.e. the Jews, the Hebrews, and what have you, they're represented by these previous cultures in the previous epochs. So I would think that there is a possibility that this knowledge does get passed even through epochs.
Oh, I certainly believe that.
Yeah.
You know, but again, I have not found that character per se as being a character in these other cultural traditions. And it might be that I just haven't run across it. But, you know, now there are stories. I will take it back. There are stories that talk about, and I can't, you know, please excuse my vagueness. It's some new research that I've been doing that come out of, like, Britain and some of the Welsh areas, but they kind of scatter around Europe as well, that talk about, like, these fairy people coming and stealing your baby and putting in, you know, like a wooden mannequin as a replacement.
Creepy.
You know, it's really kind of bizarre. You know, so that kind of thing happens, but, you know, not the true sense of the Lilith mythology. You know, and one of the other things is that I have yet to find any source material of the Lilith mythology. And to be honest with you, anything that I find that has come out after 1940, I find suspect and require to have verification of where that source material came from. Because I think that there are a lot of people that pull stuff out of their butt and they put it out there and say, well, this is how it is. And then you dig down their source material and you find out it's a lie. And I will not put out lies. Now, I might put out misinformed half-truths, but I make a lot of efforts to put out things that either came from source materials or has corroboration in other qualified materials.
Well, that satisfies me. I guess there's only one other thing I wanted to mention real quick, and that is when you said that most of this manipulation and this collection of genetic material and what have you is happening on this physical plane. I do believe that these entities are working on higher levels of density where they are able to extract this material quite easily and alter reality on our level. Through with their manipulations from a higher level. I don't know, is that that jive with what you're thinking at all?
I try to keep it on the physical plane. I mean, I believe that there are multiple levels of being and dimension, but I have not personally been out there and experienced them. And so it becomes a very speculative matter. And I choose not to speculate in that area. I mean, I'm not saying that it can't, but I just choose not to speculate in that area.
Have you ever?
We don't know.
Have you ever tried DMT?
No.
Just wondering.
Stephen's very, very interested in teaching people how to develop their psychic abilities. How would you recommend someone to develop their psychic abilities, Rita?
Practice, and more practice, and more practice, and then trusting the things that you get and the information that you receive. I mean, it's a very simple process, in my opinion.
How do you suggest they practice?
Well, that's a pretty loaded question. I mean, we all receive information daily, you know, and so, you know, and even in my situation, when my kids were growing up, so I have two stepkids, and when they were growing up, they would come home and go, yeah, blah, 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 and that was really a coincidence. And I would stop them and go, okay, so what happened? It's like, well, you know, I went to school, and for some reason I thought I was going to have a test today, and we had a test. Isn't that a weird coincidence? It's like, no, you were having a psychic moment. You know, and I think we all have psychic abilities, you know, but psychic abilities are like dancing or our ability to draw pictures. Some have them more, you know, or are better at it. Some people not as much. You know, but we're always receiving information from the world around us. And once we start recognizing that we are receiving this information and then validating that we have received the information, that's how we start to develop our psychic abilities. A number of years ago, I gave a presentation. I was part of the National Speakers Association. They had this course about, you know, polishing your message kind of thing and marketing your platform, and this class that I took. And one of the things that we had to do was to do a 15-minute presentation in front of the group, and there was kind of like a guest speaker person who also was going to critique what we did. And so they asked me if I would be one of the first people to give a presentation, you know, which was the next week, you know, but I already had canned presentations. I'm like, sure, I'll just do my psychic presentation. And I walk up to the front of the room and I'm like, okay, so are you all ready to become psychic today? And the first thing that happened was this giant wall came down. Boom. So I was like talking literally to a brick wall, which was really uncomfortable. Mm. And the feedback that I got on the little questionnaires, it says, well, your presentation was enjoyable, but your topic was questionable. From the woman who was the evaluator, sure, other than going up in front of the room and talking about the guy who was ahead of me for my critique time, on her paper, she wrote, I didn't get it. Okay? Now, keep that in mind. So 3 weeks go by, a month, I don't know, some period of time, but it wasn't really a long point in time. I mean, because basically I talked about the different kinds of abilities. You know, one of the things that I talked about, well, you know, if you're thinking about Mary and Mary calls you up, it's because you are having a psychic moment. You know, you are receiving the communication from her, and that was on a fifth chakra level and blah, 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 blah. And so I'm at one of the meetings, and the woman who critiques me comes up and goes to me, I have to tell you this. The other day, I was thinking about my girlfriend who I hadn't seen in 3 years, and there I am walking through the supermarket, and who comes around the corner but my girlfriend? She goes, isn't that amazing? And I looked at her and I said, well, then I guess you get it. And I walked away.
Aha. Do you have any other questions, Stephen?
No, but I appreciate you letting me come on. And Rita, was nice talking to you. And hopefully
nice
we'll
talking to
get
too.
To that again.
I'll send you and Rita a friend suggestion on Facebook after the show. Stephen's got a show, Rita.
Oh, yeah. You're going to have to come on my show, too.
So what's your show? Your name looks really familiar to me. That's why I was like, I think I know this guy.
He's been on Truth Connections a couple times too.
Yeah, I've been all over the place since last November. I've been kind of hit the streets in last November at the Alchemy event. Since then, I've been all over the place.
Rita's going to be at the Alchemy event soon, aren't you, Rita?
In June.
Oh, I'll be there then. But listen, it was nice having getting to chat with you guys, and enjoy the rest of your show. And I'll be listening, and I look forward to talking to you soon.
Thank you, Stephen. Have a great day.
Thank you.
All right, Kathy. Bye, Kathy. Bye, Rita.
Bye, bye. Rita, what do you think is going on between human and ET contact? What do you think? Some of that is a MyLab situation or a typical abduction situation?
Well, I mean, I do not consider myself a UFO person in the general sense of the word.
You have delved a little bit into regression, haven't you?
No, because one of the things that I learned early on after getting my certification as a hypnotherapist is that I would go right into trance with my clients and be in their past lives with them.
Mm.
So, I mean, I utilize that some of the techniques and methodologies with my clients, but I don't do tradition. I don't do that because I just go there and then I'm pretty useless as a therapist. You know, it's interesting because I am just so on the fence as to whether there's a current extraterrestrial presence or not. You know, it's kind of like my cognitive mind is totally split. There's one part that says from a mythological basis, I mean, I do believe that there were extraterrestrials here in our past. I do believe that firmly.
Mm-hmm.
okay? But when I bring it into the current, I don't know. It's kind of like there's a part of me that does not want to own it, even though all the things are many, many of the things that come out of the UFO community are completely supported by our mythological record, completely. But then in the same breath, some of the things that come out of that community, I don't want to know is true. You know, like people are being abducted. It's like, no, I don't want to be driving at night because I don't want to be abducted. I mean, there's some stuff. I mean, it's kind of really scary. And I think that part of me that doesn't want to deal with, like, that scary part, you know, like the reptilians and their the reptilian agenda and all of that stuff. It's like, if it's true, God help us all.
I know you have some thoughts about the book of Genesis, too. Would you like to go into that?
Some thoughts?
Yeah, about this. Go for it.
Which one?
Whatever you feel like saying. How it relates to ETs and such.
Well, I mean, I think the book of Genesis, you know, parallels mythology from around the world. So, you know, you kind of didn't blurt it out before, but when I was telling the story about Rama and the ape men, mm-hmm. and the gods telling, you know, Vishnu telling the gods to come down and have relations with the apes, that didn't make you think of a biblical story?
Totally.
So what one did it make you think of?
It made me think of Adam and Eve being genetically manipulated.
Oh, but see, to me, it has a much stronger connection.
What are your thoughts?
In those days, Nephilim walked the earth.
Right.
And then the sons of God mated with the daughters of men. You know, and, you know, it's interesting because I have a YouTube channel. I have multiple YouTube channels, but the one that is my personal YouTube channel is Science and Spirit Meets. And I've been making these little video learnings that are like, 5 to 10 minutes long, or no, 10 to 15 minutes long. I mean, I have a couple of shorter ones that are more meditation oriented, but they're about 10 minutes long that cover a number of different topics. And one of them was, who are the true Nephilim? And oh my God, they're, let's put it this way, I had to take the comments off because there was just a lot of really negative comments being made on that page about me, which pissed me off.
Yeah.
But anyway, you know, but it's really interesting that there is, for some reason, you know, I was talking just a second ago about unless something, I can validate something, then I won't make a claim, or I have to feel very strongly that it's the truth. And so there is this common belief that the Nephilim were the giants, or the Nephilim are, well, one, are the giants, and two, are the byproduct of the union between the sons of God and the daughters of men. So there's two different pieces to that belief. And when asked, most people, this is one of the biggest slams I get, but in the book of Enoch, it clearly states that the Nephilim were their byproduct. And I always have to say back, no, it doesn't say that in the book of Enoch. It says it in the book of Jubilee. You know, and the book of Enoch talks more about the fallen angels and why the flood happened, you know, because they had brought denigration into mankind and taught them all the secret arts, taught them how to do metalworking and taught them herbology, and they taught them all these things that we weren't supposed to know. Anyway, but when you look at that narrative from a mythological perspective, one of the reasons, mythologically speaking, that mankind was created at all was to do the labors that the giants had originally been doing, because the giants lived on the earth prior to the creation of mankind. Giants equals Nephilim. Giants equals earthborn. Okay, so when you read that passage, in those days, the Nephilim walked the earth, and in the days after, it's a true statement, mythologically speaking. The giants did walk the earth, and they walked the earth in the days after. Then the next line goes, you know, and then the sons of God, you know, mated with the daughters of men. But it doesn't say that they had giants as offspring. You know, it talks about that they had great men, men of renown. You know, if we look at some of the offspring in other cultures. You know, we have Zeus having relations with an earth person and the offspring is Hercules, you know, or we have another god having relations and the offspring is Perseus, you know, so we have this series of demigods that are created, interestingly, kind of in that appropriate time frame. Again, in the Indian story, the gods come down, have relations with the apes and the monk and the bears, and their offspring are these ape men that have special powers. Ooh, kind of like our demigods. Ooh. You know, and so I keep trying to put out that information that, you know, you should really read the Bible for what it says and maybe do some research around it. You know, and not take what someone says because someone said, oh, well, that's what it says in the book of Enoch, because it doesn't. And, you know, before you go saying that this is true, then you should find out if it's true. The lad had a question that kind of fits in where we are. And so the question is, what about giants on the earth being dinosaurs? And it is a possibility. You know, one of the things that we commented on, although we could not, you know, one of the things in writing Man-Made Chronicles of Our Extraterrestrial Gods was that we provided the reader the myths. You know, this is what this myth said. This is what this myth said. And we tried to keep our speculations out of it, you know, and try to just present you with the information so you could make your own conclusion. And if we did put in our speculation or some kind of conclusion, our best guess estimate on a topic, we were pretty clear, you know, well, our line of thinking was this, you know, and if you follow this out, this is where you end up. So that's how it was presented. One of the things, you know, in the Genesis account, so we had the plants being created magically with no sun, and then the sun, moon, and the stars. And then on the fifth day in Genesis, the writer refers to diversity of life on earth in the form of monsters and creatures. And so it talks about, we have flying creatures filling the air and sea monsters swimming in the water. Now, granted, they didn't say dinosaurs walk the earth, but as you recall, reptiles and amphibians existed prior to this and survived the Permian-Triassic extinction event. You know, and so could they have been referring to these giant creatures? I think so. You know, because what's interesting is on the sixth day, which is the day that mankind is created, they talk about animals being created and they are domesticated.
You stop in Egypt, they have those depicted on hieroglyphics, domesticated wild animals. A giant, so to speak, of a person with a lion for a pet or something like that is what I mean.
You know, but it's interesting because, you know, it says, let the earth put forth living souls according to their kind, domestic animals and moving animals and wild beasts on the earth. Now, the first domestic animal, other than what they believe is the dog, did not appear until about 9,000 BC, right around the same time that we discovered how to do agriculture in the Fertile Crescent, which is kind of in that Turkey area, and actually where they've identified the origin of domesticated wheat was about 30 kilometers from Göbekli Tepe, which I find kind of an interesting little thing.
That is.
But what they don't tell you is that not much after that, they started domesticating rice in China, and they started domesticating sweet potatoes in South America. You know, so, you know, they lead you to believe that it all started in the Fertile Crescent and then it spread out around the world, but that's not how it seems. It seems like these little things sprung up in these different areas. You know, and speaking about domestication, one of the things that I found, it was one of those little like, you know, it was up there with the wheat and the miracle. You know, I feel like it should be called like the miracle of the wheat. It has just such a, you know, nice religious ring to it. But this is yet another one of those miracles. And most people don't think about it. They don't talk about it. I mean, I don't even think anybody would. So there's two parts. One, did you know that basically they identify the last animal that has been domesticated on the planet? So it started about 9,000 BC, 8,500, 9,000 BC. and ended about 2500 BC. Okay, so we had a window of what, 5,000 years, 6,000 years, that we domesticated everything, you know, okay? Mm. And since that point in time, we've had 5,000 years, and, you know, we have not domesticated one thing. And we're supposed to be smarter.
Good point.
You know, so it's like, so were we so smart that we could domesticate these animals? Or was it more like day six that God created domesticated animals and gave them to us? I don't know. We don't know. But it's just one of those little quinkening things. But in that whole domesticated animal thing, this is the one that struck me the most. So between 4,500 and 3,000 BC, so we're talking about a 1,500-year window, every animal of labor was domesticated. So we have the camel, both kinds, the horse. So the horse was in, I want to say in the Middle East. The camel was in like Turkey, a little more Arab, and in Egypt. You know, because we have the one hump and two hump camel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they're in two different areas. And then we have the llama in South America in a 1,500-year window.
That's not a lot, is it?
Well, it's not a lot. It's just, and they're all animals of labor. You know, I could see maybe in the Fertile Crescent, you know, it happened 6,000 BC. And then in this other area, maybe, you know, 2000 BC, but it's just kind of like this little window. Like, they decided they needed, you know, transportation platforms, and they gave everything.
Elephants, too, for that matter.
But elephants aren't 100% considered domesticated.
Okay.
They're tameable, but they're not domesticated. They're not dependent on humans, per se.
Right. Good point. Rita, I want to give you we have about 10 minutes left, but I'd like to ask you, ever since I had a teacher in third grade, Mrs. Kolb, I'll never forget her as long as I live, she opened the door to Egypt to me after King Tut's tomb was opened, and ever since then, when I was a little girl, I wanted to be an archaeologist. And
me too!
I know you have an interest in archaeology as well, and I know you've also traveled abroad, and you've seen some sites. Would you care to tell us what some of the things you've seen? The artwork or a dig.
Wow, you just like make me sound like I've done all this stuff and I haven't really done jack.
did you hear your intro? Come on, lady.
I mean, really, you know, archaeological site wise, I've really only been to Mexico, to Chichen Itza and that surrounding Mayan area. Spent a couple weeks going from it was my honeymoon. What does Rita do on her honeymoon? Go check out archaeological sites.
That sounds cool to me. I like that.
Oh, man, it was so much fun. But I think that's interesting that you liked archaeology. See, that was my first love before ESP.
I just tried to dig up stuff in my backyard, but I never found anything that was worthwhile.
I mean, I went to Catholic school, and I was, like, so into the theory of evolution, and the nuns really didn't appreciate it.
Oh, I bet not.
And, they didn't like it so well. But then, you know, in eighth grade, we had to do this, like, we had a whole year to do it, and we had to do a paper on, you know, what we were going to be when we grow up, you know, this career paper. And we had to write about what it was and find out the educational requirements and what you would need to do in order to have, like, a successful career in that field and whatever. So I was going to be an archaeologist. My paper was called Archaeology is What I Dig.
I like it.
It had a pyramid on it and everything.
That's groovy. I like it.
I know. It was so 70s. And, you know, and what was really funny, there was myself and this one other girl that wanted to be an upholsterer, and everybody else was going to be a nurse or a teacher. And it's like, okay, well, we kind of stand out in this crowd. But, you know, what's interesting is once I realized that you really had to have a Ph.D. in the field to do anything, I let it go because I was like, there's no way I'm going to stay in school that long.
6 degrees later, I'm just kidding.
Pretty much. I mean, I still got the damn Ph.D. I could have gotten in archaeology, but oh well.
Yeah, maybe it's a past life thing for both of us. Who knows, you know? Could be.
Actually, I was talking to somebody that they were looking at doing a tour to Angkor Wat. You know, that place that has those giant Indian faces carved in the side of the buildings, you know, and I mean, there's something haunting about that place to me. Uh-huh. And I don't know what it is. I mean, I'm very drawn to Egypt.
So am I. Always have been.
Always have been. But there's something really haunting, you know, and I can't even use a different word when describing that place. It is haunting. And then my husband totally thinks that I've had, like, multiple past lives in China because I love Chinese food or Asian food. You know, like, you know, you should just, like, move there.
What do you think about people thinking that certain mountains are earth chakra points?
Well, I mean, I think that, you know, making a comparison that the earth is alive, I believe that. From a psychic point of view, I have looked at and evaluated vortexes. You know, it's always interesting when you interact with somebody and their house is on a vortex or near vortex. On my show, on my radio show, on the, well, see, it's moved because I moved my show from Friday to Thursday. So it'll be on Thanksgiving this current coming year, where it used to be the day after Thanksgiving because I've always been Friday. My husband, Wayne La Liberty, who's also my co-author of Man-Made, he and I get on the air and we open up the phone lines and, you know, people can call in for a reading or just to visit or share stories. And we just blab basically for 2 hours. And but this one woman called in and wanted to know what was going on with her house. And so I asked her, I was like, okay, you know, how big are the lots, you know, because I wanted to just kind of get a general idea of how big the lots were. And she told me, and I go, okay, so 6 lots over, you know, like if you go out of your driveway and make a left-hand turn and 6 lots over, that's where the vortex is. And she goes, oh, that's the cemetery. And because she was having all these disturbances in her house. And I go, and I also get the impression that there's running water like going on under your property. She goes, oh, we have a stream that runs through our backyard.
It could also have been a place that was used for black masses. It could have limestone and quartz that causes, you know, the energy to be higher or even be on a ley line.
It was definitely an energy grid point. It was a natural vortex, and they chose to build the cemetery. I mean, you know, those old people, they did stuff like that. They could feel the vortex, and they would build, you know, churches on the power spots or cemeteries on the power spots.
Mm-hmm. There's a lot of research going into that now, and even in regards to government buildings. Some people think the Satanists are using those energy hot spots to invoke different kinds of energy to move things in their direction on a satanic level. You know what I mean? So I guess it could be used for good or bad, really.
Well, I mean, it's just energy, you know, and it's a vehicle to channel energy. You know, what your intention of using the energy is your intention.
I wonder why that cemetery was so haunted.
It wasn't that the cemetery, it was her house. She was having all kinds of disturbances in her house, and she thought her house was haunted. And when I looked, she was really on kind of the outer perimeter of this vortex, even though it went out further, but, you know, kind of the edge of the really hot spot is where her house was. But it wasn't her house. It was the whole neighborhood. And I've seen that before. I've seen other neighborhoods being impacted by the energy of a vortex. I can, like, talk to your neighbors. I bet they're all having problems.
They could be. Or they just could be, that person could be more sensitive to it than their neighbors. And the entities are like, we have a beacon over here. You know, someone who is is open to it and realizes, you know, that there's much more in this world than a normal person would, are like a beacon to multidimensional beings. She can see me. She can sense me. She can feel me. I'm going to go play at her house. You know, that kind of thing.
Exactly.
Why don't you, Rita, mention your websites and anything you have coming up?
Okay. So my primary website is www.soulhealer.com. That's soul, S-O-U-L-H-E-A-L-E-R, soulhealer.com. And that's kind of the portal to everything Rita Louise. So you can access information about my books. We talk primarily about Man-Made, the Chronicles of Our Extraterrestrial Gods. And then if you're interested in the concept of ghosts, spirits, and attached entities, which we need to talk about too. There's my book, Dark Angels, and I have two other books on there and some videos and CDs. And, you know, there's just tons of stuff on that webpage, you know, other than the products, it's all for free, including the video learnings that are on there. And you can access the radio show, www.justenergyradio.com. You can reach it from the Soul Healer page, but I'm just giving that out. It is always on Thursday nights from 8 to 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and, or you can go to the Inception Radio Network, .com. Let's see. But I have some really cool events coming up. So I'll be at the Alchemy event, or actually I will be on Skype at the Alchemy event on June 15th, and I think I'm going to be on at 11 o'clock Pacific time. Now, one of the things that I found out is that they are live streaming it, and like I'm going to do this whole PowerPoint presentation thing. It'll be pretty good, even if it is on Skype. I think it'll be good.
Sure.
But you can go in person to it's in Los Angeles, California, and I think the webpage is alchemyevent.com. But they're also going to have it live streamed, and I don't really have the information of if you wanted to sign up and tap into that live stream environment, what you would have to do with that. Actually, next weekend, so if any of your listeners are in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, next Saturday, May 25th, actually this Saturday, I will be doing a book signing at the Barnes & Noble in Plano, right next to Starbucks, which is very important. And actually, I'll be there with Wayne, my co-author, who he never is able to come to anything, but he'll be at that signing books.
Nice.
And then if there's anyone that's in the New York area, I'll be doing a book signing on June 21st and June 22nd, one in New Paltz, New York, and the other one in Albany. And so I'm doing like a short presentation and then the book signing. And then September 21st, I'll be in Fort Wayne, Indiana at the Ancient Mysteries Conference.
Great.
That's everything that I know so far.
It's been a cool show, Rita. I'd like to maybe have you back on later this year.
Not a problem.
Pleasure to have on. Thank you very much.
Oh, thank you. Thanks, everybody. Good night.
Have a great night. Okay, everyone. I'd like to finish the evening with a quote by Michelangelo. Every beauty which is seen here by persons of perception resembles more than anything that celestial source which we are all from. Now, on behalf of myself and Tamara and the entire Truth Connections team, until next time, be good to each other. Peace.
Hi, everyone. Tamara here. Just a reminder that you can connect with us through Facebook, as well as subscribing to us on our YouTube channel. That's youtube.com/truthconnection. We'd love you to join us during live shows at blogtalkradio.com/truthconnection. And for information on upcoming shows, visit our website at truthconnections.wordpress.com. Thank you for your support, and never forget that the truth is reality, and the connection is you.